Good morning, Ebenezer. Let us pray. Father God, we come to you today and we just thank you for all the blessings you've given to us. We thank you, Lord, for your love, your grace, and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to see one more day so that we can praise you and worship you. Lord, although we've had a lot of chaos in 2020, whether it was due to the racial and political unrest, whether it was due to the pandemic illness, whether it was due to joblessness or homelessness, one thing remained constant, and that is that you are an awesome God, and we know that you are in control of it all. So we thank you, Lord, for that. We thank you that we can come to you whenever we feel down. We thank you, Lord, that we can come to you whenever we need to be lifted up. And we thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. We ask, Lord, that you forgive us for any sins that we've committed. We thank you, Lord, that you continue to forgive us. And we ask, Lord, that you help us to forgive those who have not treated us kindly. Help us to forget those grudges that we might be holding on to. Help us to stop complaining, because we should just be grateful, Lord, that we are alive today. There have been almost 400,000 people who have died in the pandemic in less than a year, but you saw it to save us, Lord. So we are thankful and grateful to be here today. Lord, we ask that you continue to be with those who are sick, those who are shut in, and those who are grieving the death of loved ones. We also ask, Lord, that you continue to be with those who are experiencing joblessness and homelessness, and who are lost because they do not know you. We thank you, Lord, for the teachers and the parents who are working with the students in these virtual environments. And we know it's trying times, Lord, but we just thank you that they have that opportunity to continue their learning. We also thank you, Lord, for the ministries of this church. And we especially thank you for Dr. Bond, who has brought to us his creativity and his innovativeness so that we really know that the church is not a building, but the church is worship and fellowship with each other. And we're able to do Sunday school and Bible study, New Year's Eve services, whatever it is, virtually, because of his creativity. So we thank you, Lord, that you brought him to us. We thank you for his leadership and for Reverend Somerset's leadership through these trying times. And we thank you, Lord, that no matter what happens, we always will have hope, because that is what you have taught us. We thank you, Lord, for your son, Jesus, who is our role model. And we ask that you help us to be more like him in everything we do. Help us to love each other more, Lord. Help us to be grateful each day for everything that you give to us. We ask all this in your son, Jesus' name, and for his sake, amen.
Greetings to the Ebenezer Church. God bless you on this Sunday morning, the second Sunday of the new year. We are so grateful to gather virtually to share in this worship experience that we might be inspired, uplifted, and encouraged for the journey that is the gift of life. I do thank God for all of those persons who have participated in our worship experience on this day. I'm grateful for the song that we just heard from Sister Beverly Fitch, as well as the prayer that we've heard from Deacon Renee Mills. I'm grateful to our music ministry, our director of music, Sister Miriam Walton, and our video, our AV team, Brother LJ, Brother LaVon Johnson Jr., as well as Sister Sharon Jefferson, as they have been so faithful and committed in leading and guiding our technology ministry at this moment. Let me say to you all that I want to remind us that God has been faithful to us, to see us to this point in the new year. And because of God's faithfulness, one of the best responses that we can offer is to commit ourselves to being the best church that we can be. And in as much as you may find yourself sitting in your home wondering how you can participate, I thank you, one, for the contributions that you continue to share with the church. We are so grateful for your investment of love and resources, financial resources, that we might continue to do those things that are a part of our ministry. And as well, I want to thank you for making time to participate in those ministry meetings, those committee meetings in which you have found yourselves, be it through calling in and doing teleconferencing, or whether or not you have been a part of several Zoom meetings up to this point. I thank you. And for those of you who have not, I look forward to your participation in ways that you might create during this time in which we are not in the building. Whatever the case may be, though, continue to pray for us and continue to contribute as much as you are able, that we might be that church with which God is pleased. I invite you to turn with me to the 27th Psalm. Psalm 27. Today I want to read the text from the New King James Version. Psalm 27. You'll find these words in the New King James Version of this psalm, verses 1 through 6, and then we'll skip to the 10th verse and end with the 14th verse. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and my foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in God's temple. For in the time of trouble, God shall hide me in God's pavilion. In the secret place of God's tabernacle, God shall hide me. God shall set me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Therefore, I will offer sacrifices of joy in God's tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. Let me skip to verse 10 and read through verse 14. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a smooth path because of my enemies. Do not deliver me to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and such as breathe out violence. I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. My brothers and sisters, for a few moments that are mine, I'd like to use as a thought to guide these reflections. What to do if the worst should happen? What to do if the worst should happen? Family, there is no quick fix or easy solution to what we witnessed this past Wednesday. We are in for a season of real concern and struggle. I do not want us to be deceived. I don't want us to be misled. In addition to the ongoing pandemic and the unrest around matters of race and racism, political unrest is front and center in the news. And this political unrest seems to be something that we have not known or felt before. For most of us, though, our material reality did not change the next day. So we might not realize the effects of the insurrection and attempted coup that we saw the other day. It might not have sunk in with us beyond the level of anxiety. But the anxiety that you felt last Wednesday was and is real. It is born out of the illogical story of freedom that this country tells. And yes, it is an illogical story. For it is a story that makes up this idea that this nation always is teeters on the possibility of greatness. Yet, we seem to wallow in the category of moral mediocrity. We witness an act of domestic terror that is familiar to the millions of black people who have lived long enough to know the roots of this nation. We witnessed domestic terror that was a horrible sight that brought fear in the hearts of so many people on this last Wednesday. I, like you, watched the coverage of the events of January 6th and felt my own rage and anxiety rise. There were too many contradictions to name in this awful moment, too many contradictions that have led to what we saw on this last Wednesday. For I have to tell you, it bothered me that the man who is supposed to be the leader of the government can claim that the system that he runs is rigged against him. It bothers me that the people who have enabled him for 4 years now want to silence him. I am convinced, though, my brothers and sisters, that we have all been complicit on some level, failing to check the promoters of the backlash that released this new instability. We have failed, I tell you, to really lift up our voices and our votes in ways to tell the people who have enabled those persons who brought that insurrection among us to silence this foolishness. My brothers and sisters, whether it is hyperbole or some other form of imagination, we have believed that the U.S. Capitol building is a fortress and our democracy is a pure and untainted ideal. Yet, we saw the images of dread on the faces of our legislators as insurrectionists breached that fortress by way of tearing down doors and knocking out windows. In that moment, our politicians and their protectors had no real plan for what they would do if the worst should happen. There was an eerie feeling that came with this attempted coup of our government. One might have asked the question, if we cannot protect the people who make our laws and the building where they work, how safe is our democracy and the ideas that inform this fragile political experiment? Our social and political relationships are fragile in this country at this time. They've always been, really. We have divided ourselves using markers that are often superficial or beyond our control. We use markers such as race and ethnicity, class and education, cities or suburbs, natives or immigrants, or gender and sexuality. Our rhetoric is filled with us versus them language that ignites hatred in too many people in this world, and especially in this nation. My brothers and sisters, we are chipping away at the sacredness that is humanity by seeing difference as a threat. By seeing difference as a threat. God made us different. Different skin complexions, skin tones, different sizes, different heights, different types of languages, different types of accents to our languages. God made us a diverse creation. And yet we want to use that gift that God gave us by way of our differences and use those as markers for how we ought to divide ourselves, rather than as artistic ways in which God has shown God's love in this world. And though we share this great big city, this state, this nation, and this world with other people, some people among us are making all of the above, all of these markers, and in all of these spaces where we find ourselves, they are making them points of contention and making this world less and less safe for everyone. So my brothers and sisters, I believe the psalmist can give us some kind of reflection that walks us into a moment in which we might get closer to God. For the psalmist understood the anxieties of living in a big world with dangerous people and circumstances. This psalm of David points out that times arise in life when our interactions with other people do not feel safe. He felt or realized that he was up against insurmountable odds. He had imagined in his time how he would respond if the worst should happen. He had played it out in his mind and forecasted the scenarios. His faith did not wane, though. This song is a plan for how to proceed in his life and even for us, even if the worst should happen. He looked for a way to persevere, even as he noticed the determination of the people who were persecuting him. You see, this 27th Psalm is an answer to such pressing anxieties and concerns for our day, too. We have the strength and support to grow and thrive beyond this current moment. Yet we have to be really intentional. We have to look forward. We have to strive forward. We have to practice our routines to get ourselves ready and prepared for how we might break through and find the strength and the courage to press on, even in the face of the challenges in our lives. And I will not lie to you, I won't ignore the bad things that have taken place over the last 10 months alone. I will not ignore, though, that some good has transpired too. We are here in 2021 by the grace of God. Matter of fact, that's what my grandmother would say. Grandma, how you doing today? I'm here by the grace of God, is her usual response. My brothers and sisters, people have been awakened for good to a new reality, one that has pushed aside some of the ways in which we have fought and some of the ways in which we have seen each other as rivals. For example, there are children finding ways to help out their classmates during this time. There are family members who are reaching out and figuring out new ways to celebrate their loved ones in this time. I tell you, the reports are not all bad, and there is evidence to prove that some people are facing bad times with faith, love, and hope. There are partners out there who can testify, just as the psalmist did, that they are striving to seek God's face to make sure that they find refuge in God's house, in God's presence, even in moments of despair and discouragement. The psalmist, I tell you, provides enough insight and encouragement to help us develop our own plans for the troubling circumstances of our time. There are times in life when our society and our interactions with other people feel unsafe. There are times when our society and our interactions, our relationships with others in our world feel unstable, whether our antagonists are in our home, whether our antagonists are in the air that we breathe, in our minds, or knocking down the doors of the United States Capitol. We can receive the courage and support that we need. Just as the psalmist gives reason for courage, we too can take courage and heart when any adverse condition, when any adverse people rise up against us. So what do? If the worst should happen, my brothers and sisters, if the worst should happen, if that hypothetical should come upon us, I encourage you and I encourage me to let God be our place of strength and hope. Let God be our place of strength and hope. I know that sounds abstract. I know that seems like something that a preacher would say, and I'm a preacher and I said it, but I want to walk through this if you don't mind. The psalmist makes clear that life presents us with difficult moments. The challenges of life are unavoidable. You know that, don't you? There are things that we plan to accomplish, and rarely do we place on our agenda or the scripts that we have for our lives the roadblocks that we will face on life's journey. Who can account for a surprising health diagnosis? People do not leave the house with the intention of getting into a car accident. But the unpredictable happens. We cannot always account for the unpredictable. What may even be more challenging is when we encounter the ill intentions of people. The list of names that we can use to label the hateful, the low down, the conniving, the selfish, the mean-spirited people in this world is too long for me to offer in this sermon. Yet you can picture them in your minds, can't you? You know those people. They seem to go out of their way to make your life harder. There seems to be a club of all of these people where it seems as if they sit back in their club meetings and devise strategies on how to make our lives miserable. But they have been around forever. And if I were to be honest with you, I would tell you they're not going anywhere anytime soon either. For their impact in this world will continue. Yet the psalmist relied upon his faith in God to overcome his fear of the persecution that he felt. His song crescendos with his desire to be present with God. For in God, the psalmist has found a safe place. He testified that the worst may come. Mama and daddy may leave me. My friends may betray me. My enemies may rise up against me. But my plan is to seek God's face. To find that place of strength and support, the psalmist said, I'm going to look for him. I'm going to look for God. The psalmist said, my enemies might be strong, but I believe that my God is stronger. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord, the Lord, the Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the evildoers come, when the wicked, even my enemies, try to surround me, when they come against me to do harm, my heart shall not fear. When they surround me like an army encamped against me, I have confidence in the Lord. For this I desire. I want to live in the house of the Lord forever. I want to find God's favor and cozy up to that spot and find my courage, my comfort, and my strength. The psalmist knew that he could not run from the realities on the ground. My brothers and sisters, troubles will always be with us. One psalmist said that one who is born of woman is few days but of much trouble. We're not going to run from the realities that there will be trouble in our lives from time to time. Yet the psalmist knew that he could find strength in the God of the universe. He believed that the God that he worshiped was stronger than the gods that inspired the hatred of his adversaries. I do not want to dismiss, my brothers and sisters, the psalmist's need for physical shelter and safety. He may have felt real danger from his enemies. He may have felt that he needed to find a hiding spot. The war that he referred to might have been the physical conflicts of Israel or the political conflicts of crisis of a divided nation. But I do not want to dismiss, though, the mental fatigue and anxiety that informed this song either. Life sometimes requires that we find physical shelter from danger, yes, but it also requires that we find spaces of wholeness and healing, that our mind might be able to rest, that our heart might be recharged, that our bodies might be renewed, that we might find solace in a safe place so that we can get to where we need to be in the Lord. Life sometimes requires that we find the social and psychological shelter from the vitriol and hatred of people. The psalmist then may have needed a moment to recharge for the times in which he lived. He did not want to retreat. He wanted a period of renewal, though. Let's make this distinction. He was not trying to hide necessarily from life itself, but instead he needed a moment to recharge. He needed a moment to renew himself. He needed to be close enough to God to know that someone had his back. My brothers and sisters, the psalmist looked for a place of support and strength, and I encourage you to do the same. His faith pointed him to God, and I encourage you to do the same. His faith pointed to the God of inspiration, the God of Sabbath and rest, the God of health and healing and wholeness, the God of comfort, the God of renewal, the God of strength, the God of grace, the God of mercy, the God of endurance, the God of might, the God of majesty, the God of wisdom, the God of love, the God of compassion. In the time of trouble, the psalmist said, God shall hide me in God's shelter. My sisters and brothers, as I get ready to close this message, the long record of Scripture reminds all of us that we do not face the fears and anxieties of this moment alone if we seek out God in faith. Our faith can lead us to a place of strength and support. Our faith can lead us to a community that helps to prop us up when we're weary, helps to lift us up when we're down, a place where God's Spirit resides and where there are people who care deeply about you, and that's one of the expressions of God's love. For our faith can lead us to that place of strength and support, and if the worst shall come, we can face it together. Our faith will guide us through this moment. I know what we saw the other day. I know the anxiety that it caused. I sat up in Bible study with us as we talked with one another, as we stayed on after the Bible study was over to talk together and pray together. I remember watch night service in which I heard the prayers of my loved ones, our family members, as we talked about how it's been rough, but God has remained with us. So I hear the words of Scripture reminding us, teaching us, as the Apostle Paul told the church at Rome, for I am convinced, I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things that are to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Maybe that's not enough for you. Maybe you need to hear more encouragement. Maybe you need to know that through the thick and the thin, God will remain with us. Maybe you need to hear that when the tough times come, God won't run and hide from you, but God will be right there marching beside you through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Maybe you need to know when those anxious moments hit, when those times when your spirit feels unsettled, when you can't find a way to get calm, you need to know that you're not in this thing alone. Well, my brothers and sisters, Jesus had a word for you, had a word for his disciples, and has a word for you as well. For Jesus had to remind his disciples that, yes, times will come when there's trouble. These things have I spoken unto you, Jesus said, that in me you might have peace. Peace, oh, that's a beautiful word in such a moment like this. These things have I spoken to you, that you might have peace. In this world, you shall have tribulation. But, don't you love those conjunctions, especially the ones that help change the tone of a sentence, that remind us that although the first part of what we experienced might not have been what we wanted, might not have been what we planned for, might not have been what we thought we can handle, the conjunction comes in right there and switches the mood, switches the tone, helps us to see that there is a brighter side to things. In this world, you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. I have overcome the world. That's not enough for you? Lo, I will never leave you nor forsake you, even until the end of the world, our Lord and Savior tells us. So I need to share with you, the end of this psalm, the end of this song, so to speak. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path. Then let me fast forward just a little bit, knowing good and well that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. You don't have to wait until heaven. You don't have to wait until heaven to know God's presence in your life. The psalmist said that I can see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living, as I like to say, for the living of these days. So my brothers and sisters, what should we do if the worst should happen? Find shelter in God. Seek out God. Try to find where God is and cozy on up to God, that you might find and feel the courage, the love, the hope, the support that God wants to make available to you, and that you might feel a peace that passeth all understanding, and that that might guide your heart and your mind through Christ Jesus. Let the church say amen. Amen. Receive now the benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with all of us, both now and forevermore. Let us all affirm this by saying together, amen. Go into the peace of God, my brothers and sisters, my family, until we meet again.